Welcome, everyone, back to Cat's Eye on the Future. Tonight, we have a very special show for you this evening, an entire one-hour interview with author and Runemaster Freya Oswin. Just a note on this week's show, there were some very nasty storms going on in Europe while this show was being recorded, and that led to a few glitches in the volume and quality of this recording. I did my best, when editing, to make sure we could all hear as much as possible of the interview, even though in places it may sound just a little bit funny. I sort of amped up the volume, so the voices may sound funny, but you should be able to hear the information. Also, I want to welcome back all my listeners on the Time Monk Radio Network, but I also want to send a special welcome to our new listeners at Pagan Radio UK and a brand new Heathen Radio Network. I'll be posting links and information on all of these networks up at my website so you can explore their wide range of programming. That said, I invite everyone to get yourself a cup of tea, sit back, and let Freya take us on a very personal and very special journey through her views and observations about the Norse gods, Norse cosmology, and a lot of other topics. Back to Cat's Eye on the Future. This week, we have a very special show for you tonight. We have a full interview with our special guest, Freya Oswin, author and mistress of the runes. Thank you for coming tonight, Freya.
Thank you, Melody. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Fantastic. Now, last time we had a talk with Freya, she talked mostly about the runes and their background, which, of course, I read sometimes on the show. But tonight, I thought we might talk a little bit about the background, because Freya mentioned towards the end of her last interview about how in order to work with the runes, it was a good idea to understand Germanic cosmology, a little bit about the Germanic and the Norse gods, and just in general about how those people saw the world, how Germanic people and today see the world. So I'm just going to turn over to Freya and ask her to sort of give us a 101 basic overview of Germanic sort of everything. Okay, Freya, over to you.
Okay, I will do my best, but you got to understand that I no longer base myself on lore. I base myself on my own experiences of what
I... Well, you can share some of those too.
Okay. I understand the gods to be, and I think this is, there are so many different levels, like what are the gods, are they like people, can you interact with them, person to person, are they a conglomerate of input of everybody since the dawn of time, invoking and naming the forces who then later became more personified as gods. Are they only restricted to the Viking Age? No, they go back further. They go back a lot further. But the Viking Age, that's when stuff was written down in the main. So that is what we have to work on. But if you look at Odin, everybody knows Odin by now. And this was funny because in 1993, when I partook in a certain ceremony, I swore an oath, half jokingly, that I would make his name a household name. And yeah, that seemed to have gone up. But what do you think of when somebody mentions Odin? What do you think of? Chances are, what comes to mind is an old man, a Gandalf type wizard, seeking and exchanging knowledge, and that is wonderful. But there are other sides to Odin. It's almost as if there are different strands of a common origin, but expressing itself on a different frequency. Like, in all of the runes, you can find something about Odin. If you look at the mythology, just add stories. Try to make the connection between this particular story and or myth or poem and which runes you can associate it with.
Just you think about Odin, and you were saying that he was kind of a Gandalf-type figure, and actually, that leads me to a really good question, because one of the things I wanted to talk about was, because this is kind of the general audience, is the fact that we actually, even without knowing it, get a lot of influence from a lot of Germanic and Norse and Anglo-Saxon things in the English-speaking world, both because of Tolkien, and also out of even things like comic books. Like you were mentioning, everybody knows Odin, but people are also really familiar, I think, with Thor, probably most right now, because of comic books and things. But there is really a difference between the way they tend to get shown in comic books and the way that the Norse or the Germanic.
Well, basically, Thor has always been more known than Odin. I mean, I found a Thor comic sometimes, well, way long before I was involved with any of it. Thor was well known. He also appears in Xena, I think, or some of those. I'm not really into all this comic stuff. I don't get it. If we go back to the tradition, certainly in Iceland and Norway, Odin was not a popular god. He was not elected, so to say. He was the boss god, and everybody knew, of course. Thor was the god of the people. Thor was the friend you talk to. Odin is the one you marry of, because ultimately, he is the god of death. There is no other way about that. By whatever form.
Okay, so basically, Odin is the god of death. Thor is sort of the god of every man. And where would you slot in, say, a goddess like Freya? A lot of people have heard about Freya, and they think of her as kind of a love goddess. But doesn't she have other aspects as well?
I think the way they portray Freya in art, and till a lesser extent on one of my books, well, presumably Freya, I think actually it's insulting. Most of the pictures you see of her, she's a slapper with her tits hanging out. She's not. She is a very, very strong goddess. She is the mother of witchcraft, sorcery, faith. She is the one, the chooser of the slain. She is the one who has the first pick on the battlefield. Odin has to wait his turn. She is bloody powerful. And don't forget, she is the one who introduced faith into the community. Mythologically speaking, she taught Odin faith. But, of course, what we're talking about is that the safe discipline has been introduced by women. And much as I would like to, I cannot see Freya as an alternative to Venus or Aphrodite, a young, beautiful, bimbo-type girl. No offense to Aphrodite and Venus. They also have other, more powerful attributes. But in this day and age, it seems that people have to fill up a void in their own sexuality by emphasizing this kind of lower plane aspects in our gods. And frankly, I'm sick of it. They're transcendental beings. They're transcendental beings, not sexual beings.
But you were saying it too about Freya is also she gets her choice of the slain, doesn't she? She's the first one actually to pick warriors off the battlefield. And she's a goddess of war as much as a goddess of love in that sense.
Yes, of course.
As well as being also, I would say, a goddess of death and magic. So, again, we have many, many more aspects than you might see. I don't pay a lot of attention to comic books, but I have watched some of the animated films and things that, again, my audience will have seen. Yeah, but I haven't. And again, Freya tends to be overemphasized in this one direction. But again, so we have a very multifaceted goddess. Someone who I think is, I know that I personally call on when I'm doing divination.
But don't you understand that whatever the majority of people associate with a particular god or goddess will become the predominant emanation in the collective.
That's probably where we need to teach people a little bit about
We need more transcendentalism.
Okay.
We need more transcendentalism.
Could you possibly define transcendentalism for my audience?
The gods to me are models of transcendence, what they have achieved as more than human. And I believe that it is possible, it's an initiatic path what leads out of the trap and the prison planet to the freedom of the mind on the inner planes, possibly retaining awareness or not. I don't know. There are different versions of this suggestion. I mean, nobody's ever proven anything. But I think to me, when I got involved with Odin, I came at it from the perspective of an occultist, not an astrologer, you see. That became later. When I started off with Odin, I didn't know about astrologer. I didn't even know that Wodan, as I called him, from Holland, was the same as Odin in Scandinavia. Don't forget, I had no education to speak of. And later I started making the connections, but the initial contact was just purely from my own cultural perspective, the runes and the Dutch gods. This is why it didn't work out for me in Wicca, because I encountered an enormous hostility towards Wodan, especially when I fell in with the evil lawheads like Kveldelver, and by habit started calling him Odin. Oh, yes. That put the cat among the pigeons. Oh, yeah. So, I followed my own course, yeah. I sailed my own ship. I have never conformed to anybody else's rules in magic or spirituality. I go by my gut feeling.
Well, given that, why don't you tell us a little bit about how, as an occultist, you found Wotan and then how that wound in working into your personal practice?
Oh, it was. Oh, well, I was in Wicca for a while. This was in 83. And I was having, we had another priest. Me and Lionel were together, high priestess, and that. Then there was another woman. I won't mention her name because her husband is, her then partner is one of the major lecturers at some London university. But at that time, I was not very wise in the ways of the world. Although I had been married before, Lionel was my first proper relationship, if you understand what I mean. Now, when we were doing some kind of crafting, we had this guest, this woman, and we were all naked, as you are, in a Gardnerian circle. And Lionel started showing signs of interest, shall we say, and he followed it up. So that was once. And nothing happened seriously. And then the time after that, and this was on the 21st of March, 1993, she turned up again, because I didn't blame her, I blame Lionel. It happened again. And at that point, I put my sword between them, stopped, and I still didn't ban either of them. And at that point, I blamed Pam, obviously being the main beacon god. And I wasn't gonna put up with that. Then I was extremely upset because I didn't understand how it physically was possible for a man to love one woman and get a hard on for another one at the same time. I wasn't aware that it is a purely physical stimulus and nothing to do with feelings or higher interests, right? But nevertheless, I was raging mad. I rolled up my blanket, as the natives do, and moved down in the cellar. And I started just going berserk. Because I did, you know, the whole craft for me, that was it about. I'm finished. I'm really finished. I finished that evening. And I called on Wodan. And I made a connection. And from there, I don't know. I just started calling on Wodan, had the Valknut ring made, swore an oath, and got hold of a lot of books and started studying all this stuff in the 80s, the early 80s. I was always at it and made quite a nuisance of myself at occult conferences by talking about nothing else but Odin and everything anybody else said on any level. I always found some way to correspond it with Odin. Now, okay, this is what you do as an occultist. You're looking for the hidden links between things. And everything was Odin, Odin. You see, I am now so used talking with you lot at Trollsmoot and anywhere else in the world that I keep talking about Odin. But I started off with Wodan in my private ceremonies. And then I changed the coven Nordic. I put the altar in the north, started the circle in the north, and put Wodan and Freya, two lovely wood-carved statues from, what is his name, Belbaka. And I still got them, actually, and I put them on the altar, and a big statue of Thor. And that was it. The coven was nordified. Now, this was the only way for me to work. Did I want to know about Yggdrasil? I've never seen an Yggdrasil before. What do? I take the nearest neighbor, a Kabbalistic tree, and started planting the gods and the runes on it. Had a whale of a time. Edred was doing exactly the same. And he succeeded where I did not. He actually created 24 paths where I never actually got beyond 22.
So you're talking there about Edred Thorsen, who I believe Geldofer mentioned in his interview, who had written quite a number of rune books, correct?
Oh, yes.
So basically what you're telling me is this wonderful personal story about how you actually came to Wotan, and I'm happy to call him Woden or Odin, whichever you prefer.
You
came to him personally through a personal experience in a trial, and then afterwards you just sort of took the people you were already working with, the ones that were willing to move with you, and you moved into sort of celebrating what you could of the northern traditions.
Well, yes, started looking up which festivals would have been, you know, because by that time, 1984, Nigel Panic came out with some good stuff, which was very helpful. But apart from me and Nigel Panic, there wasn't really, and Prudence Jones, his partner, his magical friend partner, I may emphasize, they were the only other people I knew about who were seriously interested in one form or another of the Northern Mysteries. Apart from that, that was just the OR, and they didn't have a mystical or spiritual bond between them. Everything was, shall we say, very secular world, political orientated. Now, I'm not saying that they're wrong. I'm not saying they are this, that, and the other. No, they're not. But what I am saying is they're not occultists. Eventually, I could not stay there. I couldn't work with them. I put the runes showing off my newly made runes, you know, on the floor, and Stubba went, "Oh, Freya, you're not casting a spell on me," because I was a Wiccan. That was the kind of attitude, you know, and all. I was the only woman there. And then when some people tried it on and couldn't shock me, they started calling me a lot worse than Wicca. By this point, it was 1986, and I started Acid Through Folk Runic workshops. Doing workshops, weekend workshops, residential, for 25 quid a whole weekend at the Enclave in Lionel's big room.
And what were the kind of things you did in those weekends? What would you be telling people?
Well, actually, the funny thing was that I started off with basic meaning of runes, but then a lot of stuff I was just coming in. I now know it was mental telepathy or some weird form of channeling. The knowledge certainly wasn't mine. But anyway, and then my friend, a good friend of mine, recorded it and then on a tape recorder and then typed it all in on a fucking Amstrad, would you believe it? And that is how my first book was written. I just started talking. What happened was, and I must say, it doesn't happen anymore. It really doesn't. But what happened was, people only needed to mention Odin or Wodan or anything, and something opened up, and all that knowledge came out.
So basically, you feel like you were essentially channeling or were being used to bring through information that I think was later, a lot of it was pretty much seemed to be going along with the historical sources.
Yeah, but I had no knowledge.
Maybe not
at
every
time.
Detail.
I had no knowledge. I never went to school, never learned English. You know, I just turned up, joined the commune, and started writing a book 3 years later. I mean, the amount of editors I've had on that book, Ingvar from the OR. Christopher McIntosh, a Rosicrucian writer, Russell Scott, and that was before Llewellyn started on it. I had about 4 proofreaders, love. My English was shite.
So which book was this prayer? Was this
Leaves of Yggdrasil? And of course, Jane Whitehead, who did most of the hard work.
Yeah. Just a second, you broke up there a bit. Could you repeat that?
Jane Whitehead was the woman who typed it all in when all the stuff started bubbling up from somewhere. What I later heard from David Beth, he calls it a blood gnosis. And that what I would call genetic memory, ancestral memory. It's in my blood.
So basically what you were doing is you feel like this was somehow coming from your ancestral line, your genetic folk memory, basically.
That I accept that, yes. But originally I wasn't aware of that. I knew I had, you know, I was inspired by something, you know, and the book it was well ahead of its time, and it's still well appreciated, and occultists particularly find a lot more in it than I was aware of. But I wrote, like in Leaves of It, there is an eightfold wheel, which is past, present, you know, the eightfold wheel. I can't even remember what it did, but it's a reading to do how the past influence the future on a conscious or subconscious level. Now that I wrote that in 1988. At the same time, Michael Burchell's book, Voodoo Gnostic, came out, and I recently bought that. And in it, he's got exactly the same diagram for time traveling and in a spider web. Now, I didn't know him. I'd never heard of Voodoo Gnostic stuff, but I find the same stuff under different terms, different words, different gods, but the basic matrix, like the basic engine being the same, to compare it, you know, a car is a car, a Volkswagen has an engine, and a Rolls Royce has an engine, but the basic principle of the engine is the same. And that is what I find out when I look at other traditions. I see stuff, I go, that's what I said, and I had absolutely no idea of it.
So
I hope I'm not making a fool of myself.
No, you're not. In fact, I'm just, what I hear you saying is basically you found a lot of, particularly as an occultist, someone from an occult background, you found when you looked at different traditions, including what you were sort of bringing out, not exactly channeling, but were sort of being divinely inspired.
I already brought it out 20 years ago.
Right.
I only discovered this stuff in the last 4 or 5 years.
Okay, so in the last 4 or 5 years, you've noticed that across traditions, there are certain types of things that tend to be, if they work in one place, they work in another, basically.
Yes. It's got to do with an underlying matrix, like, for instance, Yggdrasil and the Kabbalistic Tree of Life. They're both trees. And what you can do with one, you can do with the other. In fact, I'm working on a concept of the equivalent of the 32nd path. Of course, it won't be the 32nd path, probably 24th or something, and as a way out, the initial going out on the astral.
So what is the 32nd path prayer for my listeners that might not know?
Okay, the 32nd path is the first path you take in Kabbalah, and it is the most essential one because it's the first one where you meet your guides, you go on the astral, and it is, and then, you know, it's like traveling from one sphere to another, from Midgard to, well, okay, in the Kabbalah, it would be from Malkuth to Yesod. Now, one difference with the three is that our sphere is in the middle, not at the bottom. So from Midgard, you can have different paths going to the different directions. Alfheim, I am considering, you know, we have a path straight to Helheim that's been established by Ravna, and the more people use it, the more reliable, the more tracks in the ether you get, the stronger it becomes. But we can create one to Alfheim, for instance. And the other worlds, Asgard, of course, what I mean is applying technologies and concepts of other occult traditions within a Nordic framework. Not mixing pantheons or learning from it. Translating it, if you like.
So I get what you're saying, I think, is that you can take some of the tools and some of the basic esoteric knowledge.
Yes, but we lost. Look, we lost. I reckon we lost 90% of our stuff, really. What little bit we got is in the from the later time of the dual fate periods. The truth of the matter is we may know what our ancestors were, get up to, what is it now, 1,900 years ago, but there is no way we know what they were up to 2,000 years ago. Because all we got is a bit of Tacitus and a bit of Snorri and the old Anglo-Saxon document. And Tacitus probably is the most reliable of the lot. A pagan Roman, I think, but everybody else was Christian. I mean, their stuff is biased like shit. I mean, it's all we got. But this is why I advocate, look at other traditions. I mean, look at the simplest of hoodoo work with the herbs, the roots, the beads, the implements, and then look, how would you do that within a Norse setting? Like, you know, you would find the Norse equivalent of the herbs, the Nordic equivalent of whatever god, the Nordic equivalent of that symbol, and you would basically use the same underlying structure. A circle is a circle, a square is a square, and a triangle is a triangle, and you can muck around with it in any tradition.
So are you using this primarily for magical purposes or also for worship purposes?
I don't worship in the usually term. Usually worship means making yourself subservient or submissive. There is an awful lot of this about people, about worshiping and poetry. There is a certain website, you know the person I'm talking about. It is groveling for favors to the gods. No, I don't do that. I treat them with the utmost respect, deep affection and commitment, but they are a product of an evolving universe, the same as we all are. The universe itself is not completed. None of us is completed. They are our guides, our inner plane masters, our teachers, whatever metaphor you want to use. But they are not our gods in the sense of the cultural understanding of the monolithic, monotheistic, big bully telling you the do's and don'ts. I don't accept that, no.
So you would see them more as beings that we approach and who guide us, but who are not necessarily, it's somehow morally necessarily superior or whatever, just more enlightened than we are, perhaps.
Morally superior, I don't know. Higher evolved and further on, well, they're ascended one way or another. So, yes, they are ahead of us. Morally, I'm very reluctant to bring morals into it because they are so much relative to the time.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense.
Let's face it, what about morals? I mean, homosexuality was immoral 5 years ago. Now people get married. Morals, kiss my ass. I have my own set of ethics and principles, but I don't do morals. And I don't think the gods are.
Yes, and I would tend to agree with you on that one. I was just asking for my audience. I also was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, people are familiar, I think, with the concept of gods and goddesses, determined are, basically ascended or more enlightened beings. But what about in the Norse, in the Germanic tradition, we have other sort of being spirits, Ettins or giants. You mentioned Alfheim, which is the land of the elves.
Yes.
See a lot of this in Mithgard or Middle Earth in the Tolkien work, the wonderful books that J.R. Tolkien wrote.
Yeah, that's all originate from Alfheim.
Yeah,
when I was locked at Atlantis Bookshop, I was at the end of a conversation between, I think, I don't know whether Dolores already left, but it was anyway Kathleen Matthews and another Celt Druid, and don't know the name. And they were talking about a person who's now dead, who actually wrote a complete dictionary and stuff in Elvish. And he received that from somewhere. And you may interview Kathleen Matthews and ask her that question, where this come from. But anyway, they were just talking. I was just hanging about with a fan. And Kathleen Matthews says to the other one, I wonder where this come from. And I said, Alfheim. And then I realized that Alfheim is not just one of the Norse world. It is probably under a different name. The Celtic world is Elfin world as well. You see, because the further we go back in time, the less division there is between these cultures.
Isn't the world of the elves also have some crossover with the world of the dead?
Interesting questions. I know that what is believed in the northern tradition, and that is probably the one aspect of tradition I would question severely, because I interpret the alpha as a different parallel evolutionary species. I don't think they're dead humans. No.
You have been listening to part one of our interview with Freya Oswin. We will return with part two right after these short messages. All the music used on the show today is from MusicAlley.com, your source for free-to-air music for podcasts. The artists place their music up for free to air in hopes that you, the listener, will visit their site and purchase some of their outstanding musical offerings. So after the show, why not visit MusicAlley.com and explore their extensive playlists?
She sings, she sings, she goes home in the evening with the dew all on her wings.
Have questions? The cards have answers. If you would like a personal reading with Melody, just go to my website, melodypsychicreadings.com, that's Melody with an I, psychicreadings.com, for information, or email me at melodyreader@gmail.com. Readings are available using Skype, phone, email, or even in person if you are lucky to live in Ireland. Why not find out what special messages the cards have just for you and book a private reading today? If you would like more information about Freya Oswin, her rune classes, books, and private rune readings, please visit her website, www.oswin.com. That's www.aswynn.com, a really great place to explore the northern mysteries and magical traditions.
And what about the Ettins or the giants? How do you view them?
Ettenheim, When I think of Athens, I can very well see that they were they're obviously the oldest ones of all named beings, be them Athens, Titans, whatever. They were there first, the gods came later. I think the Athens reflect a time, a time so much earlier in our recorded history. I think the Athens, I wouldn't call it worship, but the origin of ideas about the Athens probably originated in the Neanderthal mind.
That's very interesting, because I've often wondered if the Athens...
They're the Neolithic gods.
That, and I've wondered if some of the Athens, particularly some of the ones that seem to be some of the old powers, if some of the Athens were memories of Neanderthal, but also some of them might be like volcanoes or strong winds or tornadoes, things that people see and yet have no control over.
Exactly. Yes, they are the Neanderthal or any earlier even interpretation of the natural forces. People perceive a natural force, don't know what it is, name it something and start making offerings to it to make it go away, a bit like a protection racket, really. Every religion started off as a protection racket. You pay the gods to go away, to the storms to go away, the hurricanes to go away. So, you know, people interpreted these as beings, like as if the volcano has a choice in the matter. Of course it hasn't. It is a natural occurrence.
Yeah, I was going to say that in the cosmology that comes down to us, a lot of the beings that are referred to as gods are also Etons, or have their origin, their parents are Etons. So it's like the gods
nothing
and goddesses.
Nothing comes forth out of nothing. Of course they bloody are.
That's
the same ancestral tree. We descend from our gods. The gods descend from giants. The giants, hell, we don't know. Maybe they did fly in a spaceship.
That would certainly be one interesting way of looking at it. And like, as you say,
certainly. No, I am only half joking.
Yeah.
Because if you look at the mythology, Odin and his two brothers created everything that is after the slaying of Ymir, yeah? Then the Vanir turn up in the shape of Gullveig. Ergo, they were not created by Odin and his brothers. They came from elsewhere.
Can you explain a little bit about the Æsir and the Vanir for our listeners?
Okay, in short, the story is as this. The Æsir become conscious of themselves after, you know, it involves a cow and netting. Look it up yourself. But basically, at one point in the story, there is an ambassador from another race, of course, the Vanir, a lady, Gullveig, who basically created a lot of trouble in Asgard by introducing greed, called goldlust, but greed. It's not just about gold. The gold lust is based. She introduced greed. But some people think Gullveig was Freya and hate. And basically, I come more to the conclusion that it was, on one level, perhaps a cultural clash between Celtic and Germanic tribes that came down in the mythology as a fight between the gods. But on the other hand, I mean, if we look at very old Hindu and Vedic stuff, we do find the same story between two tribes of gods. And yes, they are using flying objects.
I said, are you talking about the Nimanas, the possible flying craft in the Hindu, the Vedic scriptures?
Okay. Yes. Yes, I am. And it is quite possible that the Vanir came from Pleiades, Vega, Lyra, I don't know. I haven't all of the nine worlds lined up with nine constellations yet. I'm working on it.
So do you think they actually physically came from these other star systems, or that perhaps they were, that's more of a symbolic or mythological attribution to them?
Well, I'm very tempted to say all of the above.
Okay.
These things are not mutually exclusive. They just happened on a different timeline. Very well, deeply in the past, the gods may very well have had some form of physical existence, but a lesser density than ours. So perhaps more a higher dimensional density than what they are now.
Right. So possibly there are beings from another dimension.
Yes.
Maybe to another planet. But yeah, yes, I understand now. Yeah, that's, I don't think anybody knows.
I am not saying this is it, but these are concepts I am exploring very seriously, based on the story that Odin, Willy and Bay, Onir, Hudr and Loder, whichever tribe you prefer, created everything from the body of a giant. They created everything, including humans and dwarves. But the Vanir came from Vanaheim. That clearly is a realm not created by the Aesir. And the Vanir, Frey, was given Alfheim as a gift from the Vanir. So that realm also is not in the original creation where the three Aesir create.
Now, another question, because I've mentioned this to some of my readers on my blog. How does Odin's creation of the world from Ymir, where does that come in the story of Odumla, the Uruj, the ancient cattle licking the ice off possibly the glaciers to create the modern world? What is the sequence? Can you talk a little bit about that?
The sequence is that, okay, there are two realms of extreme polarity. One is the extreme of cold. The other is the extreme of heat. The potential of heat. In between is an empty space. These two forces interact. And within that space, something emerges. A being. Audhumla. Simultaneously to Audhumla, a cow, Ymir emerged, the first of the humanoids, a giant. Ymir procreated between his arms on his legs, something like that, and begotted the race of giants, where Audhumla licked the ice, and out came a head of the first ancestor of the god, Buri. Now, Buri married Bestla, who must have been a giant stock, and out of this union became Odin, Willy, and Way. They slew Ymir, and at that point, from Ymir, they created the earth. We all know the sky is the skull, the hairs are the trees, the blood are the rivers. So I think we're talking here about a cosmological process going back all the way to mere particles interacting and creating the right conditions for consciousness to arise in the form of the three gods, who then create the physical realm. So we're talking about a densification of something involuting from another level, the new gap, down into manifestation and our planet and all that it contains. I think it's a lot more scientific than I've got actually the, I can understand it, but I can't explain it because I haven't got the right education to put it in the right terms.
I think you've done brilliantly. I think that was a wonderful explanation. And I myself had been a little confused, and that kind of helped me figure out exactly who was doing what, when, where. At least you said the tradition, which is probably a metaphor as much as anything for things that actually happen.
Of course it is. Everything is metaphor. But that doesn't mean that there aren't real happenings. I mean, how did the universe, what originated as a singularity juxtaposition between extreme cold and extreme hot? Ask the scientist. It may actually be true.
Oh, yes. And I've also, again, on another level, I've often my personal visualization of the Duma has been sort of the Ice Age cattle in the Northlands, you know, helping the forces that are represented by the cattle washing the ice as the world warms slightly, and eventually the ice melts, and that brings forth at least the modern world, or the beginnings of the Mesolithic and the Neolithic age, at least in this cycle.
Oh, absolutely, I agree with that. Yes.
Yeah, so I think there are many multiple levels, but I thought you did a brilliant job of telling that story. That was just great.
The thing is, there are many different levels, there are many different angles. Only when people start thinking in terms of either or, they're caught in the trap.
Right.
Are the gods extraterrestrials? Are the gods archetypes? Have the gods on occasionally taken on, in the words of Uncle El, the labor and heroism of incarnation? Yes, very likely. None of these three suggestions are essentially in contradiction. There is no either or.
I think either or is kind of a very Western, almost monotheistic concept. It's very different from a Germanic worldview, isn't it?
Yes, of course it is. But we're all, well, my generation certainly grew up in that kind of culture, so my generation is contaminated with it. It's going to take maybe another 50 years.
Well, as we kind of segue towards the end of this wonderful interview, I was wondering if you could say a little bit more. You said a little bit last time, but we've looked at the worlds and nine worlds, and we've looked at the various deities and stuff. I was wondering if you could, before we go, talk a little bit about the concept of the Germanic view of time, and maybe a little bit about will and weird, that kind of just a different way that is looking at the universe that's sort of different also from the Western concepts.
Okay, well, the Germanic view of time is, well, because on the one hand, there is Oortvedandisch gold, which seemed to portray the three aspects of time, past, present, and future. But in the Germanic tradition, the present was an immediate result of the past. So the past was an integral part of the present, and the future, the probability coming forth from that. So basically, there is only two concept of time, not three.
So could you just to sum up, what are the two concepts again? I just want to make sure I understand.
The present is the result from the past. The past, therefore, is absorbed into the present.
Oh, got it. So the past and the present are really the same.
Yes, because one is a result of the other. The future is what is not yet. And once that becomes present, what is now present is incorporated as the past.
Okay.
Am I talking out of me off?
No. Now I understand you. That's why I asked you to repeat it, though, because I wasn't sure I understood, but is becoming and will become past. Right, okay. I wasn't sure I understood, and you really sorted that out for me, that the past in the present, especially in the Germanic, are really the same.
Check it with the... Because he knows a lot more and that stuff than I do.
That's fine. I think that what I was sort of leading up to, actually, is I want you to talk a little bit about will and weird and about the circle that you used for divination and Leaves of Yggdrasil, I believe it was. Because I took that and made it into a reading cloth, and I found that to be really useful for divination and that concept that we're born with certain fate or weird, but that we have a will that we can meet it with. And I want you to talk a little bit about that.
Well, weird, it's all interconnected. Weird, hamenja, erlijk. It's a bit like karma and dharma. It's all mixed up, you see. It's very difficult to explain it in detail. But it seems to be that there is the conditions laid down is erlijk. They are the laws of nature, gravity, and all that, they are the conditions of this planet under which we labor. Where is ultimately individual, your individual slice of Urlok, i.e. the conditions laid down for your life at birth, either by what people call karma, i.e. making up for something, which I think is a rather naive point of view. I think, although it feels highly personal, I think we're basically is almost an impersonal machine of the universe with no regard for personal desires, needs, or want. Now, so if somebody has bad weird, i.e. a shite life, I mean, look at me, I had a shite life. You know me as being a decent, ethical human being. What could have I possibly done to deserve the life I've had as a child? But what if it isn't personal at all? What is it, a bad, negative, accumulated, dark hamia from the family what landed on me? And then I have to deal with it. That's probably why I'm the only one with paranormal abilities. That's why I'm the only one who ended up in care. And that was the only one when I became a fully fledged occultist. Right? So, because I'm aware. So, I think the concept of weird is, you know, people like to personalize everything because it makes them feel bigger, it makes them feel important. I think it's far bigger than any individual of us. It's just like, as I said, like a functioning engine you get caught up in. The whole universe is weird in becoming.
So what is will then?
Will, that is individual. There is, of course, the will in the Thelemic sense, do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. That means do that what you are meant to do. The will we're talking about is the spiritual will, not the I want will. And that is, in that case, the will is the focused intent of the hamminga you have, the will you have, and the ability to change it by using magic. I mean, you can't get around weird. You certainly can't get around Urlok. But weird can be bent. That is what you do with magic. If it's your will, if it's your weird that you get something wrong with you, then there's always the opportunity. If you go for healing or magic or even commonly a doctor, you are changing that weird and you get yourself cured. 100 years ago, you may have snuffed it.
Okay, yes, that I think that really explains it. The way someone else once explained it to me, and I don't remember who it was, but sort of weird is sort of what we're born with, what is set up for us that we cannot change. But will is how you choose to meet that weird. And you can choose to meet it head on. You can choose to try to bend it. You can choose to flow with it. But you don't just have to accept it on face value. You do have the will to choose the way in which you
of course. Everyone in our religion and will is a sovereign free soul and chooses how to meet that will. We're not free Christians who do as we're told, yeah?
Well, that's really been a great overview here, Frey, and you were talking about magic, and I think that might be another topic for a great topic for a whole nother show would be sort of,
well, magic, like, when I'm talking about magic, I'm talking about changing your own consciousness, and then with that changed consciousness work with astral forces to make your life a little bit more bearable, as in low,
yes,
magic spells, healings, readings.
Well, I think that's really another really whole interesting topic, and maybe we could really explore that a bit more on some other show. Maybe you could talk sometime,
yeah,
about ways of doing that and how people can, you know, do magic for themselves or essentially choose to bend weird and choose how they will meet their own future if that would be interesting to you, we could do that sometime.
Well, the thing is, it's all about information. The more you know about your wheel, the easier you can bend it, putting the right pressure on the right places of the web. But if you tell people who don't even consider weird, they just, oh, weird is something like karma delivers it, but don't think, try to think their way out of it, try to understand it, try to obtain information and then act on it. That's also is a choice, yeah?
And would you feel that things like we talked about before, like chanting the runes and learning the runes, would this be an important part of learning to bend weird, so to speak?
Well, in part. But it's not just the runes. It's also what they impacting on. You need a framework to project them against. And that framework can be your life. It can be your birth chart. It can be a current situation. And you investigate that, obtain every bit of information you can through a reading. And then you redress various stresses and balances in that web and change it slightly, bend it slightly. You can't eliminate it, but you can bend it slightly. All this is only my opinion. It's not law. It's not dogma. It is my Vrije Aaswinds personal opinion. And like everybody else who's got a hole in their ass, I can be just as wrong.
I want to thank you so much for sharing your opinions tonight, Frick. They've been really interesting. I know my audience has been just as taken and just as interested as I have been. And I want to thank you for being with us tonight. And I hope we'll see you again soon.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
Well, here's a health to the company and one to my last.
You have been listening to Cat's Eye on the Future, the show where we take a glimpse of the energies coming soon into your world and into your future. Be sure to join us again next time when we explore another chapter of Cat's Eye on the Future.
Well, here's a health to the company and one to my last. Let's drink and be merry.